get some eventually as guitarists, because sooner or later we feel that the guitar amplifier configuration needs a little bit extra, and with pedals you could do a whole lot more. Today I wanted to talk to you about pedal boards in particular, and I wanted to go over how I have my pedal board set up. And this is just to give you a little bit of information on how to set up pedals. For those of you who might have one or two, it's not really going to be too complicated, because obviously it's going to be pretty straightforward. If you have a drive or a chorus, you most likely already know that the drive goes before the chorus. For those of you who are starting to gather multiple pedals, and it could be drives, it could be modulation or boost pedals, etc., you might be a little confused as to what the order of the pedals should be to optimize the sound performance. So I thought I'd go over kind of the rules to how to set up pedals and what order they should be in to help you guys out. Now, let me just be clear, this is not the golden rule. There's no right or wrong way, really. You can set up pedals in any way you feel works for you, and if it's getting the sound that you need, then it's working properly. But there's a couple of things, there's a couple of guidelines that are kind of standard knowledge that, you know, you should and should not do when it comes to pedals. So I thought I'd go over that with you today. We're not gonna make this an extremely long video, so I'm not gonna be telling you exactly what every single pedal does. I'm assuming you have basic knowledge already in terms of, you know, what a chorus pedal does or what a delay pedal does, etc. So I'm not gonna describe to you all the nuances. I'm just gonna be talking about general pedal board layout and some tips that I use to help me out when it comes to that. So let's stop talking here and let's go to the pedal board and let's see what we have, and I'll try and give you as much information on that as possible. Please remember to subscribe to my channel if this helps you. If you have any other questions along the way, don't forget to comment below. I'm always willing to give you more information on your comments if I can. So let's get started. All right, so here we have my pedal board. My pedal board is constantly undergoing change. There is such a thing as stomp box addiction, as you probably already know if you're watching this video. It's easy to start off with one pedal and add to that and add to that and add to that as you're building your tone. A lot of guitarists go through that pedal acquisition period where they're experimenting with different sounds and eventually stumble upon the right combination which will satisfy them for a certain amount of time. So if you're building a pedal board and have more than one or two pedals, you will need a pedal board. It's just more convenient. If you have one or two, you can do without. But, you know, beyond a couple of pedals, a pedal board definitely makes your life easier. You know, some advantages of putting your pedals onto a pedal board like this are that it protects your pedals, protects your investment. The pedals add up very, very quickly. You know, it's easy to spend anywhere between $100 and, you know, $200 or more per pedal, and putting a pedal board like this together represents quite a large investment. So you definitely wanna make sure you protect that investment by not keeping your pedals loose or jumbled in a bag where they're, you know, they're knocking against each other, they're getting, you know, the knobs are breaking off or could get damaged, etc. So you definitely wanna take care of your investment. The pedal board also gives you the added advantage of giving you a faster setup. So whenever you go to a gig or a jam session, you know, you pull out the pedal board, you put it on the floor, plug it in, you're ready to go. You don't have to worry about connections, you don't have to worry about cables and, you know, bad connections and batteries and whatnot. So it definitely makes your life easier in that regard. Obviously, it's a lot easier to carry. You're carrying one, you know, complete pedal board as opposed to a whole bunch of pedals and wires and cables and connectors and batteries and whatever else you might need. So definitely a pedal board is a good investment. My pedal board here is mounted on a pedal train, and the pedal train is basically, it's a metal device, and it's actually made of aluminum, It's very light, but it's very solid, so it's the perfect platform to put your pedals on. I generally like to attach my pedals with Velcro. There's other ways of attaching it, such as using tie wraps, but I think, you know, tie wraps are a little bit more limiting because once it's tied in, it's harder to swap pedals in and out. So I prefer to have something that's solid yet that allows me to take the pedals and move them around if I need to. This type of Velcro that I'm using here, just for your own information, is a heavy duty type of Velcro. It's not the standard Velcro that ships with the pedal train. Oftentimes, distributors of products will also supply you with the Velcro, and it's generally not a high grade Velcro, it's pretty much standard grade. This is very much industrial grade Velcro that I'm using here. It has a very, very strong hold or bond once the pedals are snapped in, and they don't come off very easy. I can shake this around and nothing will come loose, and that's what I like about it. Some people prefer to have the lower quality Velcro because it's easier to remove the pedals. It's really up to you, but I would recommend going with Velcro as opposed to going with tie wraps, just because it's a lot easier to move things around. So if you're going to invest in putting together a pedal board, you can buy a product like this pedal train to put your pedal board on, your pedals onto, or you can make it yourself. I've seen people building them out of plywood and other types of materials. Whatever works for you, if you have a budget and you can afford to buy a pedal train, then by all means, buy the pedal train. It comes with its own bag, which is the right size for it. Makes it a lot easier to transport. If you build your own, try to build it out of a material that's not too heavy, but yet durable. I've built my own pedal boards in the past, and they've worked quite well. So whatever works for you. So I want to talk a little bit about the steps involved in putting together a pedal board like this. You know, when you're putting a pedal board together, you don't just haphazardly slap the pedals in any configuration and hope that it's going to sound good. There are certain rules, and the rules are general rules. Right? It's not cast in stone, because you do have the flexibility when putting together a pedal board to put them in sequences that are pleasing to your ear in terms of the tones, the final tones that come out of the pedals. But you definitely want to spend some time understanding some of the basic rules, and I'll go over that for you, for those newbies that don't necessarily know too much about, you know, what order the pedals need to be in. It'll help you, and it'll make your life a heck of a lot easier. First of all, when you're putting a pedal board together, if you're using a wah pedal, I don't have one on this particular board right now, but if you do have a wah pedal, generally wah pedals go in the front of the chain. And before we get too ahead of ourselves, let me explain exactly what I mean by a signal chain for those of you that are not that familiar with it, okay? So that we're all on the same page and we don't get confused, because it is a little bit confusing when we're talking about pedal boards. Generally, when we read, if we read newsprint text, for example, we generally go from left to right. When we're talking about pedal boards, and we're talking about the sequence of pedals in a single chain, we definitely talk about it going from right to left. Because if you notice on the pedal, you have an output and an input. The input is generally located on the right-hand side of the pedal. The output is located on the left-hand side. So when you're connecting pedals together, generally, if it's the first pedal in the chain, your guitar lead will go into the input, the output of the first pedal will go into the input of the next pedal, and so on and so forth. So the output always goes into the input, then the output of the next pedal goes into the input of the following pedal, and so on and so forth. Okay? Generally, you're moving from right to left. So when I say that a wah pedal should be first in the chain, it would mean that it would take the place of my polytune here, which happens to be first in the chain currently that I have. So I'm not using a wah pedal, but if I did, it'd be first in the chain. After the wah, we have the overdrives and distortions. So Next in your signal chain, you want to have overdrive pedals or distortion pedals coming next. It's common that you might have more than one. In my case here, I have two. I have a plimsoll and a pinnacle. And that's just because I like to have a lower gain overdrive and a higher gain overdrive. That's very common. After the drive pedals, you want to go into your modulation effects. So modulation effects usually are things like phase, chorus, flange, so on and so forth. So in my case, I'm going into an EP booster next, and I'll explain to you why. The boost effect is one of those effects that is almost like a wild card. You have a couple more options with boost effects. So for the time being, I'll come back to it, but let's just keep it simple for right now. So it's gonna be distortion, modulation. After the modulation, you usually have delay and reverb. So I have a reverb effects here and a delay effects here. And that's typically what you'll see in terms of the sequence. Again, it's not a rule that's cast in stone, it's a general guideline. You will find when you're doing your own experimentation that there might be certain configurations that sound particularly good for your setup and your taste, and that's fine. You can go with that. Nobody's gonna say that it's wrong if it's the sound that you like. Before I came up with this layout and I wanted to put together this particular board, there's a couple of things that I did, and I'm gonna share that with you to make your life easier as well. There's different types of pedals on the market. There's what we call true bypass and buffered, okay? When you talk about true bypass, generally what that means is that when the pedal is disengaged, in other words, when it's not on, the signal is not going through any of the circuitry within the pedal. It's basically going in into the input and out the output, and it's not coloring your sound in any way. Buffered effects means that the circuit is going to influence the sound. So your whatever pedal you're using on your board that's not true bypass will color the sound to a certain degree, and you know, it might give you something that you don't like. I'm not saying necessarily that the only pedals you should buy are true bypass, but as a general rule, they are more desirable because of the fact that they don't color your sound as much. So it's something that you might want to keep in mind when you're shopping for pedals, okay? Now, what I did when I put together this particular layout is I lined up all the pedals in a straight line, not even on the board, and I basically plugged them in the sequence that I thought I wanted to have the pedals in, and I looked for two things. I looked for A, noise. So when you're plugging all these pedals in, it's common to have some noise, and you can get noise through different things. Poor cables, you can get noise introduced into your signal chain through dirty power. And for those of you who don't know what dirty power is, dirty power is basically the power coming from your home that's maybe not properly grounded and will cause things like noise. Sometimes you'll hear radio stations coming through your amplifier or 60 cycle hum that'll be caused by the lights if you're using neon lights, for example. There's many reasons why you might get this noise introduced into your signal. And generally, we call that dirty power. So to be able to eliminate as much of that as possible, we can do a couple of things. First, when it comes to powering up the pedals, we have a couple of options. Generally, we have A, batteries, which is a very common thing to use when you're dealing with a couple of pedals. B, you have a daisy chain power adapter that you plug into your wall, and basically the adapter is one long series of plugs that are daisy chained and go from one pedal to the other. And then third, we have a power supply like what I have on my board here. So So I'll briefly explain the advantages and disadvantages of each one of those. Well, first of all, batteries are limited to 9 volts, which means that if you're dealing with a pedal that has an option of going beyond 9 volts, and today many manufacturers of pedals do give you that option. I have two on my board. For example, the EP booster here allows me to go 9 or 18 volts. The Plimsoll also does the same thing. So when you're dealing with batteries, for example, you can't go beyond 9 volts, so you can't use the full potential of those pedals. The other thing is certain manufacturers, and this is a good example as well, are coming out with pedals that have a very small form factor. When you have a small form factor, they no longer accept the space that you need to house a battery. So you don't have the option of using batteries with those types of pedals. So you have to go with something else, okay? The other thing with batteries is obviously they die. They seem inexpensive, but when you're dealing with, you know, 8 pedals or so, swapping out batteries becomes a nightmare. If you're paying $4 or $5 a battery, it adds up very, very quickly. And then you're always dealing with inconsistencies of power, where you have some batteries that are fresher than others because some pedals don't get used as much. Some are dying out while some of them are at the full maximum voltage. So it creates an inconsistency with the board, and it's not very practical. Needless to say, they also end up in landfills unless you're dealing with rechargeable batteries. So it's not environmentally conscious type of decision to be using batteries all the time. So I would stay away from batteries if I could. So the other option I mentioned earlier was a daisy chain power supply. I don't have one here, but I think there's a company called OneSpot that makes them, and there's other companies as well. So the advantage with those is that they're relatively less expensive than a power supply, but the disadvantage is that they're sharing the power coming out of the plug with all of your pedals. So they tend to introduce noise. They're not as, let's say, noise friendly as a power supply would be. They're just generally more finicky and more fragile. So yes, they're less expensive, but they're not necessarily as good. Then we come to the power supply. The power supply basically takes power from your wall, gets divided up into the power supply. Each one of these outputs is able to power one of my pedals. In this case, I have 8 at 9 volts, and I have another one at 12 volts and another one at 18 volts, okay? So I have the ability to power at least 10 pedals, and the advantage of this is that each one of the adapters that comes out of this thing is isolated from the next. So if you have a noise situation, you won't be amplifying that through 8 pedals. It'll be really isolated to one pedal, and it really is a solution that introduces the least amount of noise in my experience. The other advantage with these type of units is that they have LEDs in them. This one has a series of LEDs in the front of it. A lot of them have that now. And basically it allows you to also light up your pedal board. So if you're playing on stage or in a dimly lit room, you can see what you're hitting in terms of your pedals. And it's just an added feature that's very nice. So the power supplies are generally a little bit more expensive. They can run anywhere between $50, probably all the way up to $200, maybe more if you're going for something pretty fancy, but generally you're looking at about somewhere between $50 and $100 or so. This one's relatively inexpensive, okay? What I also like to do when I'm dealing with a power supply, and I don't want to get off topic, so I'll be brief, is I like to number each one of the cables that comes out of this thing, 1 through 8 on both ends, so I can see 1 through 8 on this side, and I can see 1 through 8 on the section of the cable that actually plugs into the pedals here. So if there's an issue, if there's a faulty cable and whatnot, once the cables are all tie wrapped together, it becomes very difficult to tell which one is which, and if there's a faulty one or something that you want to isolate, you cannot do it very easily when they all look the same. So numbering them definitely makes your life easier when you're trying to troubleshoot your pedal board. So it's worthwhile doing. Earlier I mentioned that the EP booster, the boost pedal here, is almost like a wild card. The reason I said that was because the boost will do different things, will interact with your pedals differently depending on where you have it located in your signal chain. Now, for example, if you have the boost pedal going before the distortion pedals, you're basically gonna, the booster is basically gonna give you more distortion. It's gonna amplify the distortion that the pedals are generating and give you more distortion. It's gonna hit the signal harder. If the boost pedal is coming after your distortion pedals, like I have here, then what ends up happening is the boost basically gives you the ability to augment the volume when you hit it. So it doesn't give you more distortion, but it gives you more volume. And so that if you're playing a solo, for example, and you already have one of these distortion or overdrive pedals engaged, and you hit your EP booster, it's just gonna get louder. You're not gonna have more distortion. So you have the ability to do that. And if you take the EP booster and you put it all the way at the end of your signal chain, and you leave it on all the time, then you will have the ability to color your sound. The EP booster is based on the Echoplex, by the way, and for those of you who don't know what the Echoplex is, it's a unit that early guitarists like Jimmy Page and a host of other very famous guitarists used to use. It was an echo machine, and they basically took the flavor that the echo machine was generating and they put it in a pedal format, and a lot of people like that nuance because it boosts everything and it makes it sound a little bit more punchy. So people like to have that aspect and not necessarily the echo aspect. So they basically made a pedal called the EP booster, which boosts your signal and gives you a little bit more oomph. And if you put that at the end of your signal chain and you leave it on all the time, it just typically makes everything sound better. And a lot of people like to use it that way. So there's many ways you can use pedals. If you plug in your pedals and you put them all into a line and you make sure that you're getting the lowest amount of noise, once you have low noise, you should also listen and make sure you're getting the sounds that you want so that the pedals are interacting with each other in a good way. You know that you're basically eliminating noise and getting the sounds that you want. Then you could number the pedals and start laying them out on your pedal board. Now, depending on how many pedals you have, you're gonna need a different amount of real estate. For 8 pedals, a pedal train about this size is what the minimum I would go for. So don't go with a pedal board that's too small or you'll be stuck. You won't like that. And if you go too big, you're carrying, you know, way more than what you need to be lugging around, and it's not very practical. When you're laying out your pedals and you're trying to make sure that you're getting as little noise as possible, one thing comes into play, which is very important, and it's the type of cables that you're using. And a lot of people will go with the cheapest cables because they figure a cable is a cable. It's not true. I'm here to tell you that's false. Don't be skimpy and spend a little extra on the cables. It's a couple of bucks more, but let me tell you, you're gonna appreciate it because you're gonna have less noise. You'll have less issues with broken connections, faulty solder joints, or just, you know, overall flimsy cables that break on you when you need them most. So spend the money and get something good. I like to go with the type of cables that have an angle in them. So they're not straight through, they're at an angle because they're less cumbersome, and I like to have my wiring on the top of the board tucked neatly in between the cracks of the pedals and the pedal train so that they're not in my way, so I don't accidentally, you know, hit a wire or something when I'm trying to turn the pedal on or off. I just find that those are better, the better option when it comes to connectors. you will often see connectors that are sold for pedals that are just basically two connectors put together, and they're basically solid. There's no wire in between. I would stay away from those, and I'll tell you why. Generally, when you have a rigid connection with a bunch of pedals, that's a recipe for disaster. If you're pushing on a pedal, if you notice, for example, these pedals are all different sizes, they're all different thicknesses, the location of the input and output are generally not in the same place. Some are lower, some are higher. So those type of input jacks don't necessarily work very well. Once you connect a series of pedals together, first of all, they'll be extremely close together, which is not practical. If you want to take one off your board and everything's crammed together, you basically have to pull every single one of them off to be able to access the one in the middle, which is not very user-friendly. When you have something rigid like that and you're putting pressure and you're stepping on a pedal, well, if it's not perfectly level and balanced, your pressure will affect the next pedal as well. And the last thing you want to do is to put undue pressure on the input and output connections within the pedals, because you can damage something. So I would typically stay away from those type of connectors. You want to have something that's going to give you a little bit of a buffer, a little bit of wiggle room, and the best option is just to go with, you know, a relatively short cable that has a 90 degree angle in them, and you'll be fine. That's some very good advice that I can give you, and I learned that the hard way. I tried those other connections and they didn't work for me. Once you know how many pedals you need to put on your board, then you can start laying them out, okay? And so the sequence here, you'll notice that I have my Polytune in the number one position. And the reason why I have this in the number one position is because the Polytune has a nice feature that it actually will mute the sound when you're tuning up. So it's really bothersome when you're playing with a band and somebody's tuning and you gotta listen to him tune. When I press this, it basically mutes the signal and I can tune up without bothering anyone. And I can also use this almost like as a master cutoff if for whatever reason there's noise that's happening, feedback or whatever. I can press this and it cuts the sound to my entire board. So that's in the number one position for me. From here I go into my plimsoll. From my plimsoll I go into my pinnacle. My pinnacle goes into my booster. The booster then goes into my EVH Phase 90, which then goes into my Boss CE2. The Boss CE2 goes into my Cathedral Stereo Reverb. And the stereo reverb, I'm just using that as a little bit of a sparkle, to add a little sparkle, not much reverb. And then the reverb goes into my digital delay. And the digital delay will then go into my amplifier. Hopefully I'm not confusing too many people out there, because it is a confusing thing. But generally, this is the type of sequence that I'll use with my pedals. One thing I also wanted to mention very quickly is more and more pedal builders are introducing stereo effects. The digital delay and the reverb pedal that I'm using here have stereo out, so I can essentially take any one of these and go into two separate amplifiers and then divide the sound left and right, so I can have more a bigger spectrum of sound, and I can play a lot more with the intensity of the effects. If I'm using something like a ping pong delay, for example, I can jump from left to right amplifier and really, really spread out the spectrum of sound, which is a really neat thing to be able to play with. If you do Pink Floyd, for example, and you want to play Run Like Hell and you want to get that ping pong delay and whatnot, you can definitely do that if you have stereo outputs. Okay, so the next thing I want to say is, once you have all your pedals on your board and you're happy with the layout, then you can definitely go in and either, you know, Velcro them in or secure them, whichever way you deem more reliable in your particular case. There is something that's very important when you're going to the amplifier. When you're going to the amplifier, generally today we have two different types of ways to introduce effects into our amplifier. We can go straight in to the front of the amp, or we can go in through the effects loop. Now, for those of you who don't know the difference, when you're going in through the front of the amp, sound will be influenced by the power tubes as well as the preamp tubes. When you're going in through the effects loop, your amplifier will have less of an impact on the effects, and the sound will tend to be more controlled and cleaner. So generally, what the rule of thumb tends to be is you want to put in your modulation effects or your reverb and delay into the effects loop to keep them clean. And you can generally go in to the front of the amplifier with your overdrives and distortion. So if you have the luxury of an effects loop on your amplifier, if your amplifier is not too old or not a vintage reissue or something like that, then definitely take advantage of your effects loop. You'll have a better overall sound and better control of your effects. If you're stuck with an amplifier that's a little bit older and might not have an effects loop, you're not, you know, stuck. You can still go into the front of the amplifier. You'll just have to balance the sound a little bit better, tweak a little bit more, but you can definitely still get a very usable sound going in through the front of the amplifier. It's not a big issue to be dealing with. Okay, so that's basically my rundown of, you know, putting together a good quality layout for your pedal board. You definitely want to take advantage of the technology that's out there today when it comes to keeping the noise level down. Tie wraps are always a good thing when you're dealing with the wiring, not necessarily the pedals. As I said earlier, what I'd like to do is once I have these outputs, when I determined where they go, I like to group them into two groups, 1 to 4 and 5 to 8, and tie wrap them together underneath the pedal board so that they're not loose spaghetti all over the place. It makes a very neat connection and it keeps things from accidentally being damaged or being knocked loose when you're transporting or using your pedal board. So I hope this video was helpful to some degree for some of you out there. If you have any other questions regarding the layout of the pedal board and what should go where, please don't hesitate. I'll be happy to answer your questions. As I always say, please subscribe to my videos because there'll be more videos coming your way. I'll try and produce a couple of videos every week as much as time allows. And if you have anything you'd like to see specifically in terms of a video review or gear review or whatnot, please don't hesitate to let me know. I'll try to accommodate whenever I can. So stay tuned because there'll be more great stuff coming your way.